series postdocs on the spot. So please feel free to make questions from the beginning. So today you have the pleasure of having Louis Legrand. Louis Legrand, he finished his PhD in the Institut d'Astrophysique Spatiale at the University of Paris, Paris-Saclay?
Yes.
Okay, good. In 2020. Then he spent 2 years in the University of Geneva. And now he correctly moved to IFT, UNESP, ICTP, SAFE.
Yep.
Always improving. And today we have the pleasure of listening to him about cosmology with gravitational lensing of the CMB. Thank you very much for accepting our invitation.
Thank you very much, George. It's really really a pleasure to give this seminar, and thanks a lot for organizing this postdoc on the spot series. So today I will talk to you about cosmology with the CMB lensing. I will try to make it very introductive so everyone can follow. And also, if you are lost at some point, don't hesitate to interrupt me and to say that you're lost and I can repeat, okay? Or if you have any questions. So here is the outline of the talk. I will start with an introduction of what is the CMB. And then I will talk about gravitational lensing of the CMB and especially how we can reconstruct it. And then I will talk about cosmological constraints with the CMB. So all this is an introduction. And then I will talk about what I do, so how we can improve for the next generation of CMB experiments. And then what constraints we can get on inflation, so cosmological inflation with CMB. So here is a timeline of the universe. Maybe you're already familiar with it. So there was an initial period of inflation where the universe expanded very, very quickly. So it expanded so quickly that very small quantum fluctuations were stretched to physical scales, so millimeter scales. Okay, and in this primordial universe that resulted after the inflation, it was very dense, very hot, and the photons and the matter were coupled, meaning that it's a bit like at the center of the sun, you know, where you generate photons by a fusion, but it takes 1,000 years for the photons to reach the exit, because it's always scattered into the matter. And it was the same for the initial primordial universe. So you had an evolution of this primordial fluctuation from quantum fluctuation that evolved into a small density perturbation that were evolving, oscillating between the matter that was attracting by gravity, right? That was wanting to make more density, increase the density, while the photons, radiation pressure, were pushing away. So it was like this oscillation between the photon that wanted to push away and matter that wanted to collapse. And this is what we call baryonic acoustic oscillation. Okay? And this was the initial universe. And then the universe was expanding, and as it was expanding, it was cooling down. And at some point, it was cool enough so that the first atom started to form, okay? And you have the formation of the neutral hydrogen at this moment. And when the first atom formed, then the photons were free to travel. They were not anymore scattered by the matter. And this is the emission of the cosmic microwave background, roughly 380,000 years after this initial inflation. And at this moment was emitted the first light of the universe. Okay, the photons that were free to travel at this moment, they are still traveling the universe today. So they are still in the universe, and they crossed all the universe to come to us. So this is us here today. And this image of the primordial universe, we call it the cosmic microwave background, and we can still observe today with telescopes. And then the universe continued to evolve, and there was this period where the first stars are formed, and we call it ionization, because the first stars, they are very powerful, and they can ionize the neutral hydrogen. So the hydrogen is not neutral anymore in the universe. And then you have later on the formation of the galaxies and the large gas structures that we know today. So the image of the CMB that was emitted at this moment contains also information about what is in the line of sight in front of it, okay? Because it interacted with the structures later on, okay? So if we were able to see the sky in the millimeter wave length, this is what you would see, like a homogeneous emission, homogeneous radiation everywhere in the sky, and at a temperature of 2.7 Kelvin, so very cold, but a perfect black body. And this was observed quite accidentally by these two guys, Penzias and Wilson, in the 60s. So the idea for them was to build a radio telescope, an antenna, to talk with the satellites that were in orbit. And the thing is that their antenna had some noise. Everywhere they were pointing the antenna in the sky, there was this background noise. And they didn't know what it was. And they thought it could be some problems with the cables, it could be some shit of the birds that was in the antenna. But no, it was actually the cosmic microwave background. And they got a Nobel Prize for that. And then if we increase a bit the contrast of this image, this is what you observe. So here, you increase the contrast by a factor of 10,000. Okay? So here, these are small fluctuations, local fluctuations in the temperature. So if you're not familiar with it, this image is like the sphere of the sky, okay, around us, that you put on a 2D map. So it's a planisphere. Okay? So it's like the sphere of the sky around us. And so this tiny fluctuation of small hot dots or small cold dots, these are sourced by the initial perturbation after inflation, okay, the small inhomogeneities that are coming from the quantum field, and then that evolved with this pressure of photons and gravity of matter that is oscillating like that. Okay? And this is the CMB that was observed by the Planck satellite a bit more than 10 years ago. Okay, so how do we do science with this map? So the standard tool that we have is to decompose it into a spherical harmonics. Okay, so very quickly, what it is, if you have a field, Higgs, that depends on the position of a sphere, this n vector here, you can decompose into the spherical harmonics with this multiple coefficient ALM. So it's quite the same thing as a Fourier transform, but on a sphere. Okay. And here, it's a representation of the two multiple coefficients, L and M, of this multiple development. And L is like the monopole, dipole, quadrupole, etc., etc. So it's like the number of way you decompose your sphere. And M is kind of the orientation of this of this decomposition. Okay. And for a field that is statistically isotropic, then all the information is contained, all the statistical information is contained in the power spectrum. Statistically isotropic and Gaussian, I should say. Then all the information is contained in the power spectrum, which is in fact the variance of these multiple coefficients. Okay. And this is the power spectrum of the CMB temperature, as seen by Planck. So here is like when you go to a Fourier transform, but a spherical harmonic transform, okay? And here you have the large scale, so the low multiple Ls. And here you have the small scales, so the large Ls, okay? And these red dots are the measurement of this map. And the blue line is the fit of the standard cosmological model. So what is very impressive is that this fit is very good to explain all these observations. And here is the residual of the difference between the fit and the observation. And this oscillation pattern that we see here is exactly sourced by this oscillation of the baryonic acoustic oscillation, right? That you have some scales that have compressed and some scales that have expanded at the moment of the emission of the CMB. Okay. Yes. And then the CMB, the light of the CMB is also polarized. So it's like you know, light is polarized. And this polarization of the CMB comes from the perturbation of the electron density at the moment of recombination. Because you have the perturbation of density, but also the electrons sourced are also following this perturbation of density. And they create some polarization of the light. And usually what we do is that we decompose this polarization in the base of the E and the B modes with analogy of electromagnetism, okay? And the E modes are like the radial modes, so the curl-free modes, and the B modes are the gradient-free modes that looks more like spirals like that, okay? And here is an image of the polarization as seen by the Planck satellites. So you see these vectors here, they are like the direction of polarization. And what is interesting in the decomposition of E and B modes is that if you have density perturbation in the primordial universe, then you create only E modes. Am I right? Yes. You create only E modes. While if you have tensor perturbation, then you create E and B modes. meaning that the B-modes, they are not sourced by the density perturbation, they are only sourced by the tensor perturbation. And this tensor perturbation in the primordial universe, these are actually gravitational waves. And if we have gravitational waves in the primordial universe, most inflation scenarios predict gravitational waves. So if we observe gravitational waves, it's an indication that it's a way to observe directly inflation scenarios. Okay? Yeah.
I think dust also produces B modes. No, dust.
The dust. Yes, exactly. So the main.
That's a problem, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. So the main problem of trying to observe the B modes is that you have all the signal from the foreground. So the emission from the dust of our galaxy that is also polarized. And there was a big debate a few years ago because there was an experiment that claimed having detected the primordial B-modes, but they found out later that they detected just the polarization of the dust in our galaxy, so not at all.
Is it easy to discount this background?
Yeah, it's not easy.
So it's not easy?
No, it's not easy.
Okay.
And one standard way to do is to try to observe the CMB at different frequencies. And the primordial CMB is a perfect black body, but the dust of our galaxy has an emission that is not a perfect black body. So if you observe at different wavelengths, right, different frequencies, you can try to distinguish what is the emission of the, what is the signal from the primordial CMB and what is the signal from the foreground. And then another contaminant that I will talk later is gravitational lensing, and we talk just after. Yeah.
Okay, but just for us to not get lost in the technical jargon, what is dust in this context? Sorry.
It's so you have our galaxy, and you have some dust. Yeah.
Light dust.
Like, you know, when you form a planet from a protoplanetary disk, it starts from small dust and then aggregates
into
planets.
It's literally dust. This is not a technical term. Okay.
No, it's totally dust, yeah. So people make jokes about it because some astrophysicists work on dust. And that's exactly that. Okay, so then there is this. Spectrum of the polarization. So here it's the same as for the temperature, but for the polarization. Here it's a bit different because it's a log scale, but here you see the polarization E-modes. And because they are sourced mainly by the density perturbation, they have the same shape of this oscillation that we have in the temperature. And the polarization B-modes, these are the blue lines, and there are different contributions. The primordial B-modes from primordial tensor perturbation are the light blue. And because we didn't observe it, we don't know what is the amplitude of this primordial B-mode signal. And here I plot for two different values of this parameter R, that is called the tensor to scalar ratio, that parameterize the ratio between the amplitude of the scalar modes, so that source the E-modes, and the tensor modes, so that source the primordial B-modes. Okay, so large R is a large primordial B-modes, and small R is a small primordial B-modes. And then there is this dark blue line, which is gravitational lensing B-modes. So these are B-modes that are produced by gravitational lensing when the CMB crosses the universe. And we talked a bit later. But as you can see, it almost dominates the signal at all scales. Okay.
So a question. This is a theoretical calculation, or this is an observational?
No, this is totally theoretical.
Theoretical.
Yeah.
And what did you assume to make these two, what is this small r?
This R is a ratio between the amplitude of the density modes, so the primordial perturbation in the density, with respect to the primordial perturbation in the scalar modes, in the tensor modes, sorry, so in the primordial gravitational waves. So it's kind of the ratio of the red over the blue, but not directly, because the red also has all this evolution during the moment where photons and matter was coupled. Well, here it's a parameter that is the ratio at the end of inflation, so earlier. It's kind of related to this. Okay. It doesn't work. Yeah. Okay. Contribution to lensing. This I said. Okay. So now a few words on the standard cosmological model. So this model is called lambda CDM. So lambda for the cosmological constant. which explains the observed accelerated expansion of the universe that we see today. So we see that the universe is expanding and every day is expanding faster, so it's accelerating. And this can be explained if we include this lambda in the Einstein equations. And then cold dark matter is a model to explain the missing mass in galaxies and galaxy clusters that interacts only by gravity. So all the matter that we know is in this 5%, in this baryonic matter, okay, that composes the galaxies, the stars, the gas, and everything else, 95%, we don't really know what it is. And to observe to predict the power spectrum that I showed earlier, the fit of the Planck observable, Planck power spectrum, we only need 6 free parameters. So H naught, which is Hubble expansion, so the Hubble constant, sorry, so it's the expansion of the universe today. Omega B and omega C, which is the relative density of baryonic matter and relative density of cold dark matter in the universe today. Tau, that is a parameter to measure the reionization. So it's not directly a cosmological parameter, but it's like an effect that we see in the CMB also. And then AS and NS, which explains the amplitude and the shape, the tilt of the primordial power spectrum, so the primordial fluctuation of density after inflation. Okay? And with all these 6 parameters, we can explain the observed CMB power spectrum. And yeah, in the talk, I will also talk about sigma 8, which is another way to talk about the amplitude of the power spectrum. And then we have some standard extensions. So the main one is the sum of the neutrino masses. So we know from oscillation experiments that the neutrino have a mass, but we don't know what is the absolute mass of the neutrinos. We only know the difference between two different mass states. And the neutrinos, they have an impact on the growth of structure. I will show a bit later. So we can obtain constraint on the sum of neutrino mass from cosmology. And then there is this tensor to scalar ratio that I already introduced. So some open questions in cosmology. What are we trying to answer? So the big one is, what is the nature of dark matter and dark energy? Then what is the mass of neutrinos? And did the inflation happen and how? And to answer these 3 questions, we need... Okay, to answer this, we need to make a new survey, so a new observation of the universe with better statistical power. And this is what is... First, there is here a summary of a recent observation of the CMB. So in blue, it's observation from the Planck satellite. And you see that it's very good for the large scales of temperature up to quite small scales in temperature. Is not so good for the E mode, and it doesn't observe at all the B modes. Okay, here it's temperature, E modes, and B modes of polarization. And then we have a next generation new experiments like a Southpole telescope and the Atacama Cosmology Telescope in red and orange that are mainly targeting the small scales in temperature and E modes. And then there was Bicep Keck and Polar Bear that are observing the B modes. So we see that we're kind of reaching to the place where we should observe the primordial B-modes from inflation. But for now, we are totally dominated by the Lenzing-induced B-modes. This is a black line here. Okay, so, yeah. So here, I think it's just an illustration. It's not a measurement.
Yeah, but how do you know the B-modes if you don't know what R is? I'm confused. You have a graph, but...
So we know the Lenzing-induced B-modes, this black line, because this is derived from the E-modes. I will explain later how this is formed. Yeah. And this dashed line is just a guess. We don't know the value of R. So we have new experiments coming on. So in the CMB side, we have mainly a Simons Observatory that should start to take data this year. And then in less than 10 years, there will be a CMB Stage 4, so on the ground, and Lightbird in space. And they will both try to target the B-modes. Lightbird in space will try to get the very large scales, and CMB Stage 4 on the ground, the bits smaller scales. And then, interestingly, it's also a decade where we'll have a lot of observation of galaxies. Right? There is DESY that already started more than a year ago, and that will soon release its first data. There is Euclid that started last summer. And next year, there will be a Vera Rubin LSST observatory. So just to mention that currently with Rogerio, we are part of LSST. And one of my projects is to do a cross-correlation of CMB lensing with LSST. I will not talk about it today, but if you're interested, we can chat later. OK, so what is gravitational lensing of the CMB, and how do we measure it? What time is it? I should go faster. OK, so gravitational lensing is a deflection of light by the mass. OK, so if you have a galaxy in the background, and then you have a very massive object, like a galaxy cluster in the foreground, then the light is deflected by an angle that is proportional to the mass. And for the CMB, it's the same thing. OK, so you have the image of the CMB in the background, and the light of the CMB crosses all the structure to come to us. So it's also deflected by the large-scale structure by a gravitational lensing. OK? And this is a simulation of the CMB, the free field of the CMB. So on top is the temperature. Here is the E mode of polarization. And here is the B mode of polarization, assuming there is no primordial B mode. So here there is nothing in the beginning. And if you have a lensing field, this is what you do. If you look at temperature and polarization, if I swap between the two, you can see it deforms a bit the image, OK? Because the lens will deflect a bit the path of the photon, so it deforms a bit the image of temperature and E modes of polarization, OK? And we see also that it creates B modes. And this we can understand roughly by the fact that if you have a polarization pattern, and then if you have a lens in the foreground, then if you deform a bit your polarization pattern, something that was gradient-free in the beginning, you will create some curl-free, sorry, in the beginning, you will create some curl modes. And these curl modes, these are the B modes here. Okay, so it's like a geometrical deformation that creates this B mode signal. Okay.
So if I understand, if you see the B modes, you have to discount lensing effects before yes. concluding that you had some kind of inflation at the beginning.
Totally, yeah.
I see. So yes. this would be some kind of foreground.
Exactly, yeah.
OK, I understand.
Yeah. And this, if I have the time, it's the last chapter of the talk. I talk about that. And so, the so locally on the power spectrum, what does lensing do? It deforms like the patches of the CMB, OK? If you have a lens, then you will magnify your CMB patch, so everything will appear bigger. So in power spectrum terms, it means that everything will be shifted to the left, OK, to the large scales. And if you have a void, an absence of a lens, OK, so then it will demagnify your CMB, so everything appears smaller, and it will shift your power spectrum to the small scale, so to the right, OK? So locally, depending if you have a lens or not, the image, the power spectrum image, the power spectrum of the CMB, sorry, is shifted a bit to the left, shifted a bit to the right. And this is what it does in the power spectrum in terms of the amplitude of lensing. So this is this AL parameter. In the standard lambda CDM model, we have lensing equals 1. And if you have more lensing, then you go to the red. And as you can see in the temperature, if you have more lensing, then you smooth your power spectrum, OK? You smooth the peak and trough of your power spectrum. It's even more visible in polarization. And this you can understand by if you do the average of a power spectrum that is sometimes to the left, sometimes to the right, if you average out, then you smooth everything, OK? It's like you convolve with a Gaussian or something like this. So how do we reconstruct the CMB lensing? So if I give you this image of a pool and I ask you, can you tell me what is the shape of the waves at the surface? Maybe you can make a guess on what is the primordial image of the bottom of the pool, OK? Maybe we can guess that all the lines are parallel and orthogonals, and all the squares have the same shape. And then by looking at this deformation, you would be able, in principle, to reconstruct exactly what is the shape of the pool at the surface. So for the CMB lensing, it's the same thing. But here at the bottom, we have the CMB image. And we want to reconstruct what is a lensing field, okay? So what deformed this CMB field. But we don't know exactly the realization of the spots, so we can only make a statistical assumption. So we will assume that we know the statistics of the CMB. And so in other terms, we can schematically show it like this. If you have the image of the CMB and then you cut this image in small patches and you compute an estimate of your power spectrum locally, then you will measure the deviation from the average of your other power spectra, okay? And then you will be able to see if this was magnified or if this was demagnified. Okay? And this is the basic idea of the quadratic estimator. If we go a bit more in the formalism, the lensing creates some correlation between different multiple scales. So if you have a lens field and you look at two different scales n l prime, normally, if you don't have lensing, it's zero because the CMB is homogeneous, statistically isotropic. It's not homogeneous, sorry, statistically isotropic. So the statistic is the same everywhere. There is no correlation between L and L prime. But here, with lensing, you have some correlation that is proportional to phi, which is this lensing potential field that we want to reconstruct. And then we kind of inverse this relation to build a quadratic estimator. Okay, so we try to estimate phi by combining different scales of the temperature map, T and T star here. Okay. And this gives us then an estimate of the CMB lensing field. So the CMB lensing field is a product of two CMB maps. Your estimate of the CMB lensing is a product of two CMB maps. And this is what was used by the Planck collaboration. So here is a map of the lens of the reconstructed CMB lensing field. Okay. So here in this map, you have an information about the integral of the matter distribution up to the CMB. So there is a lot of cosmological information in there. And this black band is just the mask of the galaxy, okay? Because we cannot observe what is behind the galaxy, so here we mask it. And these small dots are extragalactic sources, other galaxies that also contaminate the signal. Okay, so then if we want to do some science with it, we need to compute the power spectrum, okay? So we want to compute the power spectrum of this map. And each map is already a two-point function of the CMB. So in total, your power spectrum of your quadratic estimator is a four-point function of the CMB. And if you develop this four-point function perturbatively, you can, in there, you will have the signal that you want, so the CMB lensing power spectrum, so the power spectrum of the field that you want to measure, plus some other contractions in your expansion that are some biases, some noise in your power spectrum, okay? So mainly in the jargon, we say N0 for the disconnected, the Gaussian contractions of the CMB, and then N1 is a secondary contractions that are proportional to lensing. But you just have to understand that we have this contraction in the four-point function that we want to remove. And for the Planck satellite, for the Planck experiment, this is how the noises look like. So the signal we want is a black line here. This is the power spectrum of the CMB lensing. And all these lines are different values of the noise depending on what combination of CMB maps you use for your estimator. If you use temperature on both legs of your estimator, you have the red line. And then if you use temperature on E modes, E and B, and T and B. Okay. And the best constraint is when you combine, when you do the minimum variance, okay, when you combine all your estimator together. This is the gray line here. And for Planck, you see that every scale is totally dominated by the noise. But because this noise, we're able to calculate it analytically, we can remove it from our estimate and obtain an unbiased measurement of the CMB lensing power spectrum. But it doesn't mean that we cancel the variance. We still have the variance, which is proportional to this gray line. And this is the observation. This is a measurement from the Planck collaboration. And here is a black line in the CMB lensing power spectrum. Blue and orange are two different scales, two different conservative cuts. So in blue is an aggressive cut, and in orange is a more conservative, where you cut at a scale of 400, and in blue you go to 2000. And what is interesting in this plot is that the black line is not a fit of the observation, it's a fit of the CMB temperature power spectrum. So this is a parameter of the lambda CDM model that you get from the temperature. And here it's plotted against the CMB lensing power spectrum. So it's probing a different moment of the universe, but both are very compatible. Okay, so what cosmological constraints do we get with this? So here is an analytical expression of the CMB lensing power spectrum. So the phi, the lensing potential field, yes?
CMB lensing means the lens only affects the CMB, it doesn't affect anything else in the universe?
Yeah, it affects everything else.
So why can't you use other information about the universe to tell you something about the lensing? Why are you getting all the information about the lensing just from the CMB?
So here I'm introducing only the CMB, and then I have also a result where I compare with the galaxy weak lensing. because it's a different observable. So it probes first it's different kind of telescopes. So you observe different stuff, and then it's also observe different moment of the universe. The CMB lensing observes mainly at a redshift of 2.
I just don't know what the phrase means. What does CMB lensing mean? You have a lens and you have CMB, but what does CMB lensing mean?
So CMB lensing? Yeah. CMB lensing is this.
It's so gravitational lensing, I understand, but I just don't understand what it means CMB.
Yeah, it's just a shortcut to say gravitational lensing of the CMB.
Okay, that's what I thought. Okay,
sorry. It's this field here. It's the deflection that the photons got along the trajectory. Yeah.
So I have a very naive question. And the question is, let me see if I understand the logic behind all this. You assume that you have some CMB, say 300,000 years after the Big Bang.
Yes.
And comparing to what we look these days.
Yes.
We infer something about in between, how much dark matter, how
exactly,
much,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
Okay, but I think there is a lot of uncertainty about CMB just after recombination. So how can you separate, you mean, the assumption of what was, of the features of CMB just after recombination affects a lot your conclusions about what is in between. Am I right?
Yeah. So it's
how do you manage this?
So the CMB is very well understood because all the physics is very linear. So it's very easy to predict the CMB power spectrum.
And after recombination.
Yes, exactly.
I see. Yeah. I see. So there is not much uncertainty about CMB after recombination.
It's very well, the parameters are very well constrained in the standard model.
And then
if you want to explore some other things, then you have to be careful.
I thought there were a lot of uncertainty, but in this case, I understand you.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so actually to complete your question, this is the lensing field, okay? So it's the integral of the a gravitational potential psi along the line of sight. So this is a comoving distance, chi, that you integrate until the CMB. So you integrate your gravitational potential along the line of sight, and this gives you the lensing potential field, phi. Okay. And this is the efficiency kernel, and it peaks at a redshift of 2. And it's a bit like in a standard optics. Okay, if you have a lens halfway between the source and the observer, this is where the lensing is the most efficient. And it's the same for gravitational lensing. And the redshift of 2 is kind of halfway between the CMB and us today. And this is the power spectrum of the CMB, the theoretical power spectrum. So in black is the linear one, and in red is nonlinear. So it's when you take into account the fact that at a later stage in the universe, gravity becomes nonlinear because the densities are very high. So you cannot do a linear perturbation theory anymore. And you have a bit more contribution at the small scales. But for the CMB lensing, it's mostly dominated by the linear contribution. So you're not very much dependent on the modeling on nonlinear scales. That is quite difficult to get. And this is what we measure in the cosmological parameter space. So here, it's a three-parameter plot. With you have a sigma 8, so this is the amplitude of the matter fluctuation, omega m, the mean matter density today in the universe, and h naught, the expansion rate of the universe today. And we kind of measuring a tube in these parameters. So it's a kind of optical degeneracy between the fact that you have a big lens close to us, so omega matter is big and h naught is small, or if you have a big lens far from us, or a small lens close to us will be the same, okay? We don't know this. But we can break this degeneracy by using another observable, like galaxy surveys, which measures also the distribution of matter at a different redshift. So you can break this degeneracy in distance, and you get the constraint that is the orange dot here. Okay. And these are recent measurements. And here it's comparing different observables. So the Planck lensing, so the is a gray banana here. So it's just the tube that I was showing, but plotted in two dimensions. So it gives this banana. And then you have other lensing, like you asked, the weak lensing of galaxies. So the galaxies, they're also deformed by the same gravitational field, okay? So they also probe kind of the same parameter space, but with a different tilt, because it's a different redshift. And if you combine both, then you get the red area here. And in blue is the constraint that you get from a primary CMB, so temperature and E-modes of polarization. And you see that everything is compatible. And here is a bit more recent measurements. In blue, these are all galaxy survey observation. And in red is when you combine Planck and Atacama Cosmology Telescope lensing and the galaxy BAO to break the degeneracy, and you get something that is also quite compatible. OK, so now I'll talk about the massive neutrinos very quickly. So the neutrinos, we know they have a mass. We don't know what is the mass of the neutrinos. And they impact the growth of structure. Because if the neutrinos don't have mass, this is a simulation of the distribution of matter in the universe. Okay, this is the result if you don't put massive neutrinos in your simulation. And this is the result if you put massive neutrinos in your simulation. And you see that there is less intensity, right? So the structure are a bit less formed. It's a bit smoother. And this is due to the fact that the neutrinos, if they have a mass, they still are going very fast. So they escape the gravitational potential. Okay, they are almost relativistic particles, so they go very fast. So they escape the gravitational potential. So there is less matter available in the gravitational potential to form. So this slows down the growth rate of structure. In terms of power spectrum, this is what it gives. So here is a plot of the matter power spectrum with the different values of the neutrino mass. And here is the ratio when you don't have massive neutrinos. And you see that it decreases. Okay, very massive neutrino decrease the power spectrum. So it decreases the variance of the map. Right? This power spectrum is just a measure of the variance of the map. So if you have more massive neutrinos, then the map is smoother. You have less variance in the map. And this translates into the CMB lensing observable, okay? Because CMB lensing is a kind of integrating this density field. And here is also the ratio of the CMB lensing power spectrum if you have or if you don't have massive neutrinos. Very massive neutrinos is a red line, and no massive neutrinos, then it doesn't change anything. It's zero here. And what is interesting is that the gray bands here show the constraints that you expect to get from CMB stage 4, okay? So from the next generation of CMB experiments. And as you can see, we should be able to detect the sum of neutrinos, the sum of the mass of neutrinos with CMB stage 4. And these are current constraints that we get from cosmology. The best constraints that we get are when you combine the CMB lensing plus primary CMB, so the green here and the blue line, together with a galaxy BAO to break this optical geometrical degeneracy, right? And we get this constraint here, which is of 0.12 electron volts at a 95% confidence limit.
Didn't you write before that the sum would be about 1. Something electron volts, or I'm wrong?
Yeah, it was in this simulation, but it's just to show what will be the impact.
Ah, okay. Yeah. This is just a numerical simulation.
Yeah.
Okay, just
yeah.
to.
Yeah. Just.
Okay. I see. To see something, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
To,
exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
I see. Thank you.
Yes. No, it's a very, yeah. Yes. Okay. Okay, so now I will talk about what I do, so how we can improve for next generation experiments. So just introducing the CMB stage 4 experiment. So it's composed of two different surveys. So there will be one in the Atacama Desert in Chile with two telescopes that will observe a big part of the sky, okay? So this is an image of the sky, and the red lines show the survey area at a very small scales. So it will make a map of the CMB at very small scales in all this area of the sky. And then there is another part that is on the South Pole, and there the scope is to observe for a very long time a small area of the sky to have a very good signal-to-noise ratio to be able to observe the polarization B-modes of the CMB, because one contaminant when you're observing from the ground is the atmosphere. Okay, you have some perturbation of temperature in the atmosphere, and this changes a bit the signal that you get from on your telescope. And to be able to remove this, you have to observe for a very long time the same patch of the sky. So this is what they will do in the South Pole. But what is interesting for CMB lensing is this map, this case here, because this will observe the small scales on a very large part of the sky. And with CMB stage 4, we will be able to observe the lensing-induced B-modes of polarization, so this dark black line here. Because here is an illustration of the Planck noise level, okay? It's this green line. And with CMB stage 4, we will go down, we will go to this one, and we will be able to see directly the lensing-induced B-modes of polarization. And the interesting fact is that these B-modes, they are directly produced by the lensing of E-modes, okay? So if you're able to observe the E-modes plus the B-modes, one is coming from the other by lensing, right? The B-modes are just produced by the E-modes. So if you're able to invert this relation, you get an image of the unlensed E-modes and the lensing potential that created the B-modes that you're observing. And this can be achieved with iterative lensing estimators. So this is a simulation, okay, of the CMB. This is of the lensed of the CMB lensing field. Sorry, here is the input of the simulation, and here is what you're able to reconstruct with the quadratic estimator, so the standard estimator that was used until now. And here is the difference between the reconstructed one and the input one. And because the noise is so low, we are able to go beyond this standard two-point function. Right? In practice, it's using higher-order modes. But what we do is to iterate several times on the lensing reconstruction. So you first get the first estimation of your quadratic estimator, then you use it to delense your observed map. Okay, you move back your map to what it should have been before lensing, and then you estimate the residual lensing signal that is still there in your map. And you do that several times. Okay, you iterate until you have removed all the lensing signal in your map. And as you can see, the difference residual, it's much nicer than in the quadratic estimator case. Okay. So one big issue with this is that if you compute the power spectrum of your map, you don't know what happened in practice to your two-point function, right? Because this map is not anymore a two-point function of your CMB map. So when you compute the power spectrum, it's not anymore a four-point function of the CMB maps. So you cannot derive analytically what are the biases in your power spectra. So what we did is to take a heuristic approach and to assume that we can get them analytically, that we can get them analytically with the same expression as for the standard quadratic estimator, but by iterating on it. So we start with our CMB lensing potential and the E and B modes of the lens CMB. We then estimate the biases of the quadratic estimator. And from that, we can estimate what is the delense signal, so how much lensing we're able to remove in the spectra. And then we put this residual spectra back in the analytical expression, and we iterate on that until it converges. And the nice thing is that it's working. So here, I plot only the noise, okay, only the residual after we subtract the signal that is the purple line. The blue one is for the standard quadratic estimator, and the orange one is for our iterative estimator. The dots are when you do the simulation, and the plain lines are from our analytical expression. And as you can see, it matches very well. So the prediction that we get matches very well our simulation. And this, with our iterative estimator, we're able to reduce the noise, okay, so this line, by a factor 2. So in the end, this increased by 75% our signal-to-noise ratio of the CMB lensing power spectrum. And we demonstrated that by trying to measure the sum of the mass of the neutrinos. So here it's the marginalized constraint on the sum of the mass of the neutrinos, where I did a simulation where the neutrino mass is 0.06 electron volts. If you use only CMB, primordial CMB, and galaxies, you get the brown line. And if you combine also with our iterative lensing reconstruction, you get the orange line here. And this gives us a 4 sigma detection of the sum of the neutrino mass for CMB stage 4. And it was the first time that we predicted based on a full pipeline of the simulation, based on simulation, but with a full lensing reconstruction pipeline, that we can get these constraints on the neutrino mass. Okay, then if we want to be a bit more realistic, we need to take into account the fact that your experiment is not ideal. Because in the simulation I did, everything was ideal, everything was isotropic and under control. In practice, you have some noise pattern and you have this mask. This noise pattern, for instance, is from the Planck satellite. And you see that there are some parts of the sky that are very low noise, and some parts of the sky that are much higher noise. And this is due to the fact that the Planck satellite is rotating to scan the sky. So it came several times to the same spots when it was rotating to scan the sky. And the problem is that if you do a Lenzinger reconstruction, everything that looks anisotropic, everything that is not the same everywhere, will look like lensing for your estimator, because this is what the estimator is looking for. So if you have some anisotropic noise pattern, then you can reconstruct something that you think is lensing, but you're just looking at the noise. And for this, we developed, we adapted a tool that already existed for the standard estimator, but we adapted it for the iterative estimator, which is called realization-dependent debiaser, that combines some simulations with the data map. And we show that we can obtain unbiased estimates of our semi-lensing power spectrum. So here, the colors are for different simulations where we have non-ideal cases. For instance, we have this anisotropic noise in purple. We have a strong atmospheric noise in green. We have a fiducial cosmology where the lensing amplitude is 10% less than the assumed cosmology. A cosmology where you would put some strange wiggles, like a cosinus signal in the semi-lensing power spectrum. And in all that, we show that we can get unbiased constraints on the semi-lensing power spectrum. Okay, so now in the last 5-10 minutes, I will talk about inflation and semi-lensing. First, maybe, are there questions in the previous part? Okay, so I'll continue. So here is a compilation of observation of the B modes of polarization since 2005 up to the most recent one in 2021 by the Bassey-Kepke experiment. And you can see that we are quite reaching already the lensing-induced B modes, and we can put some upper limits on the tensor modes, okay? And the tightest constraints that we get now when you combine the Planck experiment with the Bassey-Kepke experiment of R equals 0.03. So it's around this curve here. Up. And this is also the same constraint, but here showed in the plane of R versus NS, so the tensor to scalar ratio, and here is a tilt of the primordial power spectrum after inflation. And the observation that we have are in this area in blue, and here it shows the different models, like it depends mainly on the potential of the inflation field for different values, and you can see that we can already exclude some models, like this pink area here is quite excluded already by observation. And for a next generation experiment, we're able to do better. So indeed, as I told you, this black line is a lensing-induced B modes, and it's kind of a noise when you want to observe the primordial B modes, okay, when you want to observe the light blue line. It's something that you want to remove. And if you remove it, you're able to decrease this noise to get to the red line. So you will improve your constraint. And this removal is done by delensing. Okay, so you have an estimate of your lensing field, and then you kind of move back the polarization B modes to what it was before lensing, and then you get a better observable of the primordial B mode signal. And this is some simulation that we did for CMB stage 4. So in this patch here, the South Pole patch in red here, and this is some different models of the foreground. So these foregrounds are the polarized dust in our galaxy. And here, this is the residual of the foreground signal after using some frequency combination to try to remove the most of it. And here is a result of what you obtain when you do delensing. So here it's the observed B modes, so the B mode that you get that is the sum of the primordial B modes plus the one created by lensing. Here is when you delense it with a standard quadratic estimator, and here is where you delense it iteratively using our iterative delensing pipeline. And as you can see, you can remove much more signal, much more lensing-induced B modes when you do iterative delensing. And this translates into this translates into the power spectrum like this. So this is the power spectrum of the B mode of the B mode of the polarization B-mode, sorry. In red here is the observed B-mode, so the sum of lensing plus primordial ones. In dark blue is when you delense with the quadratic estimator, and in light blue is when you do the iterative delensing. So you see that you're able to decrease much more your signal. And these are the constraints that we obtain on the tensor to scalar ratio. For two different simulations, different simulations with different foreground models here, and different values of the tensor to scalar ratio. And like a preferred value of the tensor to scalar ratio is 3×10⁻³. Is like something that is predicted by some standard models of inflation. And if you don't do delensing, then you get this error bar here. Okay, you have a lot of variance. But if you do this iterative delensing, then you get much smaller error bars, these small orange ones here. Okay, and in the case where you don't have a primordial B-modes, this is the blue points here. And in the case of R equals zero, then we get the constraint of 5×10⁻⁴. So it's much lower than the 3×10⁻³. So we can potentially already discard a lot of inflationary models if we are below, if we reach this this value. Okay, conclusion. So I showed you that CMB lensing is an almost direct observable of the matter field in the universe. It contains a lot of information. In particular, an interesting one is on the sum of the neutrino masses. If we delense the CMB polarization, then we're able to get better constraints on the tensor to scalar ratio and then to constrain the inflationary models. And then with next generation surveys, we will be using iterative optimal estimators to get better results. And finally, cross-correlation of this CMB lensing field with galaxy surveys, for instance, LSST, what I'm doing with Rogerio, will help to break some degeneracies in the parameter model and to allow to explore other interesting stuff like dark energy. Because there, galaxies are like a lower redshift and you're looking more at what is nature of dark energy. Thank you very much.
Questions?
Thank you for the talk. I wanted to ask if you can detect the difference of masses, if the difference of masses between neutrinos make any difference in these calculations, or just the sum of them.
So it's we are mainly sensitive to the sum, to the total. But then if you if the constraint on the neutrino mass reach below 0.1 electron volt, which is the minimal mass in the inverted scenario. If you're below that, then you can say we are in the normal scenario, where the smallest two neutrinos are below. Yeah. We can just put a constraint on the sum. But then in very futuristic CMB experiments, I think you're sensitive also to the exact ordering, okay. Because this makes some different imprints. Different imprints in the CMB power spectra, but it's not reachable today.
I still want to understand what lensing means. So do you have a three-dimensional map of the universe where you know where the lenses are? Is that what you mean by saying what the lens?
No, you just have the integral. You just have the integral of the distribution of the mass along the line of sight.
Yeah, wouldn't that be better if you had the three dimensions?
Yes. Yes.
But can't you use other observations to get that?
Yes.
I mean,
so
we know where the galaxies are and things like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But
if you do cross correlation with galaxies, then you're able to isolate slices of redshift.
Yeah.
And then you get a view of what's happening in the redshift band.
Otherwise, it would be difficult to see if you actually are doing things correctly unless you can compare with other observations.
Yes, for sure. That's why we have several observations. That's why we have galaxy surveys, CMB, I think.
But can you say, for example, the lensing is at least in that direction? Can you do that? Or not even? You can't even do directional of where the lenses are?
Yes, Yeah, you can. Especially for big lenses like galaxy clusters.
Okay.
Galaxy clusters, but you can see them in other other part of the spectra, okay. Like for instance in X-ray, or in if you see a big group of galaxies in your telescope, you know there's a galaxy cluster. And then if you look at the lensing that you reconstruct for the CMB, you can also see some signal. And it's a whole zoology of different observations. Okay. Yeah.
I have a question. So there is this crisis or this tension of concerning the Hubble constant.
Yes.
Right? So if I understand correctly, for students, not for you, there's a tension between what is measured with supernova and with CMB.
Yes.
And from what you said, I understand the following, that you assume that some spectrum of CMB is produced in recombination.
Yeah.
And from what we see these days, you can calculate what would be the Hubble constant, right?
Yes, that's it. For
roughly speaking.
Yeah, to get the Hubble constant today, you assume an evolution of the Lambda CDM model to go from observation of the CMB to today.
Right. You assume something in the past, see something today, and calculate something in between, namely the Hubble constant.
Yeah.
Right?
That's
roughly speaking. Couldn't this mean the fact that there is this tension between supernovas and the CMB, couldn't this mean that what we think we know about CMB just after recombination is not really correct and something has to be changed there?
Yeah, you can explore different models. Yeah, there are the different models but it's quite hard to explain exactly the CMB power spectrum without having a very exotic models, I think.
With what?
I'm not very familiar with that, but I think it's a because it's, I don't know.
So do you know what I mean? I don't know if I made my question clear. So what I mean is the following: that we calculate the Hubble constant with CMB.
Yes.
Assuming something in the past.
Yes.
So why not changing this something in the past in order to fit with supernova?
Yes, there are some models like that. It exists, but it's not something that we. There is also models that tries to explain both CMB and supernovae together, but I think it's not super super efficient until today.
Okay.
I think that's the thing. But there's a lot of people working on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So my question is, how much of this is a real tension and how much is our ignorance of the past? Because for tension, just to explain, to qualify what I mean by tension. By tension, I mean that when you have two theories, when you trust them a lot, and you have different outputs, then you have a tension, a crisis, something like this. But in this case, we have much uncertainties because we're talking about the universe. So concerning CMB, what's the weak points that we can distrust the output for the Hubble constant and say, look, there's no tension at all. The problem is that we didn't understand we have a lot of uncertainty concerning the past, and this is the reason why we think the Hubble constant would be larger.
Yeah. But actually, H-naught is a measure of the size of the patches of the CMB, kind of, because it's just telling you how close the CMB is from us. So if the physical size is small or big, depending if it's far or close to us. And if you change any model that will change the distance of the CMB to us, we'll be able to explain a different value of H-naught, I think. So there is a lot of models. And the tension is only in Lambda CDM. Like the standard model of cosmology says H-naught is this way.
Okay.
And observations of supernovae, the advantage is that they don't assume Lambda CDM. They are direct observation of the expansion rate of the universe today. So they don't do any assumptions of the cosmological model. And the tension is in that, is in between that. Is in this lambda CDM model with the CMB, we see this.
I see.
And with supernovae, we see something different. And the thing is that because supernovae don't assume lambda CDM, then there's a lot of people exploring extensions to that.
Yeah. I see. Okay. Yeah. Other questions about the universe? No? Okay. So let's thank again Louis for the colloquium.